Greetings viewers, my name is Anshika Upadhyay and my project is on Random Key MTA Security that I have done along with my teammates Ms. Niharika and Ms. Divya. So it's quite obvious that it's all about encryption algorithm and it is based on MTA. So let me first give a brief introduction about TEA. TEA came about in 1994. It was designed by two scientists, Dr. David Wheeler and Roger Needham, and created a lot of ripples because TEA offered advantages such as a lot of ease of implementation and very less delay in computation and very less power consumption, very less cost, and also. Resistance to differential cryptanalysis that made it very strong, and it was very lightweight cryptographic algorithm because it included only 7 lines of code originally, and that code included basically a loop on a Feistel block, and that loop was repeated in 64 cycles. It was based on Shannon's rule of diffusion and confusion. It diffused and confused the plain text with the encryption key. So it made a lot of impact on the other algorithms, over the other algorithms that were that are still very complicated in nature based on the basic theorem of prime factorization, and it is very complicated. It takes a lot of power consumption, lot of delay in computation. So TEA actually proved to be very efficient over there. Now, it had demerits, that is, there was correlation between 2 or 3 keys, and that lessened its length to 126 bits from 128. This was a major drawback, misused in Microsoft's Xbox 360 also. So that was overcome by MTA. We'll look into that in detail. So this, you can see, is one Feistel block of TEA. These are the two inputs, 128 bits of plain text divided into 64 bits each, and these four are the 32 bits key, which makes up 128 bits. And we can see that there are bitwise operations performed here and not any concept of prime factorization that makes TEA very simple to use. So this is one cycle. This Feistel block is repeated 64 times. Now let's see what happened in MTA. So as I mentioned, the biggest drawback of TEA was overcome by MTA with the help of LFSR, that was linear feedback shift register. What it did was it removed the correlation between the keys that was happening, and it again re-established the strength of TEA with its advantages with a simple add-on of LFSR. So with this it increased the efficiency of the algorithm, and it is basically meant for use in embedded systems, especially if we take the example of RFID security, which is very critical to less power consumption and less cost, and it cannot afford too much of hardware and software overhead. In such kind of systems, MTA security can actually help a lot. But still, there is a major drawback with MTA, and that is that it still comes under the class of symmetric key algorithm, that is, one key is being used for encryption and decryption. So there is a major concern to save the key, as in to protect the key so that it is not lost to any corrupt system. It is not leaked, and moreover, it was not found to be so efficient for a multiple system environment, and it was not giving absolute security. So the aim of this project is to enhance MTA with more add-ons and to make it perfect so as to be used in such environment. So we have done this with the help of two processes. One is validation, and one we have added something in the encryption process. Let's look one by one what exactly we have done in validation process. First of all the participating systems have to send across a key to the central monitoring system, and that key has to be a multiple of E naught into 2 pi by n. Now what is this E naught? It is a threshold energy which is set by default for this environment, and this concept comes because we visualize it as a circle with a constant radius of E naught, and the number of systems are distributed as equally spaced points on the circle. So therefore, the spacing between any two consecutive points will be E naught into 2 pi by n, and between any two random points will be an integral multiple of E naught into 2 pi by n, and that is where this concept comes. Although it looks very simple, but it is derived from information coding techniques, and I can assure you that it actually ensures the uniqueness in the identification of any system.
6 minutes.
So once that is done, we come to the encryption process. In encryption process, the first thing that we look into is to protect the key so that it is not vulnerable to leakage. So how do we do that? Obviously, the one answer that can be a solution to this question or to this problem is that we can, instead of making the key constant, we can keep on changing that, we can pseudo-randomize it, and we can avoid the need to store the key. We can rather store a function in each and every system, a pseudo-random function based on still the same variable n, which is a varying quantity as we know, because the number of systems can keep on changing in the environment. So this function will be a function of n, and the key will keep on changing with the help of the function. But still all the systems will every time agree upon the same key, all of them. So this is how MTA becomes more robust, and then comes the question, where can this security algorithm be used? It can be used, as I earlier took an example of RFID security. I think that is the best example of first using it, but it is not just restricted to RFID. We can as well use it in any closed circuit environments, any embedded system based project, even in ATMs, and I think the most security intensive applications such as electronic voting machines can make use of this, because it will reduce the power consumption, the loss, the cost, I'm sorry, and it will enhance the security many folds. So it can be very easily used in any security intensive applications, and it provides a very high efficiency and secure way of communication. Right, so this was about
8 minutes ago.
The introduction. Now let's see how the working takes place. So as I was telling you about the energy computation, we have a threshold energy. As you can see, this is AA, and this is basically a string, but it is providing me with the threshold energy E naught, and this is the code, the MATLAB code for the computation of energy. Now what I can do here is I can enter any string combination here, and I can click on run. Let's see what happens. Okay, so I see here that the combination that I entered is okay, this E naught is what we can see here. It is a threshold energy of this AA. Finally, we see here that the energy
9 minutes
is this much, and it comes out to be the integral multiple of the formula that I told you already. And so we see that n was initially 0 and it has incremented to 1. Now let's see what happens if we give the same value.
9.5 minutes.
So you can see that because it is the same, it has incremented to 2. And now if I give some other value. Now you can see that It has again gone down to 1. Actually, this is a small glitch in the program. And it is just starting right from the beginning. So what is happening is that here, it is not an integral multiple of this value. And hence, it has got decremented. Okay, now, after we see that this has been successfully implemented, now we see the encryptor block here. So as you can see that this is the Feistel block, and this is the text divided into two halves and the passkey divided into four halves. So I've entered a 128-bit text over here and a 128-bit passkey. Even if we enter more number of characters, it accepts just the first 16 characters in this. So here the passkey has been divided into, the input passkey is divided into four parts. And when I run it, I get, these are the two output strings, C1 and C2 in hexadecimal representation, and these are the two what we see in the string representation. This is the final passkey. So in decryptor block also the same thing happens, except that it runs in the reverse way. So what we are supposed to do is these passkeys are given as input to the input passkey, and the final text, the final encrypted text is given to the plain text, and we get the exact string, the plain text back in decryption process. So this is how it is implemented. However, certain practical considerations are not taken care of, which can be taken care of when we make use of some hardware module of an RFID or of an RFID that we were not able to procure because of some reason. So if we do that, we can exactly show how efficiently it works. So this is it for now, and hope you enjoyed the video and liked the working. Thank you very much.